Your computer is inefficient. And I don't mean to say that it's slow. Chances are it's faster than mine, no contest there. But every computer, every phone, every game console, anything that does math at room temperature is fundamentally inefficient. Unless you're operating a superconducting quantum computer in space, your processor likely requires a cooler. This is because passing current through any normal conductor generates heat. Sometimes that's a good thing. That's why incandescent light bulbs exist. It's basically just a thin piece of wire getting so hot that it's glowing. But in pretty much every other case, that heat is just an unwanted side effect of your 500 Chrome tabs. But what if I told you that this heat can carry information? A side channel attack is a type of cybersecurity exploit where an attacker gathers information from a system by analyzing its external properties. In smaller words, if your computer is hot and loud, I know it's doing something important. If I really, really hate you, that would be a good time to unplug the power. Of course, there are more practical uses for this outside of corrupting homework, at least theoretically. Wikipedia lists an anecdotal attempt at decoding an encryption key with an oscilloscope plugged into the target's power supply. Now, jokes aside, I'm not gonna deny that many cases of side channel leakage are real concerns, primarily in radio communications and many centralized systems. But what I want to know is how much data can you extract from a regular desktop computer? In other words, my goal is to find a way to roughly identify what my computer is doing without looking at my monitor. Here's a simple program that makes my processor really busy for about a minute, and then does nothing for another minute, effectively simulating an intermittent workload. And here's the waveform of the audio from my computer case. The correlation is clear. When the CPU is under high load, it gets hot and the fan spins up. When it's idling, the fan returns to its default speed. This creates a fuzzy square wave of binary ones and zeros. Some might be quick to say that this is proof of data leakage, that under specific workloads, this could expose what I'm doing. But I wouldn't be so sure. Issue number one is that this heavily depends on environmental factors. Throughout my testing, the wave pattern remained consistent for about 12 minutes, at which point the computer heated up the room it was in and the fan could no longer pull any cold air. That's not to mention that I had to turn off my case fans and adjust the CPU fan control settings to get any pattern to emerge from this experiment. My motherboard only supports 4 discrete fan speeds, which severely limits the granularity of the output data. I could barely measure a difference between 2 states, let alone enough to estimate any practical workload. Let's try something else. Mechanical hard drives spin their platters at a constant rate. For many consumer drives, that's 7,200 RPM, which means that a heavy metal disc inside this thing is doing a full rotation 120 times per second, every second. Unsurprisingly, the sound from that is audible. The idea is that by listening to this noise, we can tell how much data is being used and how often. Here's another program I wrote that spins up and stops the drive in 10-second intervals. Keep in mind that doing this severely shortens the lifespan of the hard drive, which is why I'm using an old garbage disk for this. No healthy piece of technology was harmed during this experiment. Anyway, here's the audio for that. As you can see, the square wave is much more consistent than last time. But this isn't entirely fair. In reality, the spin of a hard drive doesn't depend on its activity. When powered, a hard drive will maintain a constant RPM, even if it's not connected to a computer. In this test, I'm explicitly sending an instruction that forces it to shut down. In any normal workload, this would certainly never happen. The other option is to listen for the actuator arm moving the head of the drive. During non-sequential reads or writes, this arm jumps around all over the place, which of course makes a sound. Depending on the age of the drive and the fragmentation of data, this can directly correlate with disk activity. Unfortunately, these days most computers run on solid-state drives, which make no noise whatsoever. Still, for the sake of science, I got an old laptop hard drive, placed a microphone on top of it, and installed Counter-Strike. I filtered out the general frequency range of the relevant noises. These bright spots represent the sound of that mechanical arm jumping to a different part of the disk. During the download, these jumps are short and evenly spaced. And that makes sense. Downloading large files on an empty drive is usually a sequential write process, so the drive head doesn't have to move very much. However, at one point in the recording, we do get a longer run of these jumps. Looking back at the video, this corresponds to the exact moment that I skip the shader caching and start up the actual game. Once again, this makes sense. The game data that was just downloaded is now being read from the disk, and since this is no longer limited by the speed of my internet connection, those short bursts can all happen one after another. Interestingly, once you actually get in-game, there's practically no disk activity. This is because, by now, all the relevant assets are loaded into memory for quicker access. The next major spike of activity is actually when I'm quitting the game, and I assume that's because it's saving progress or something. But as I said, most modern consumer machines use solid-state media, so mechanical noises like fans or spinning disks are becoming less and less relevant with each coming year. But believe it or not, that's not the only thing making noise in your computer case. Coil whine is a phenomenon where electromagnetic coils produce a high-pitched noise when handling high current at high frequency. It's especially prevalent in the voltage regulators of graphics cards, as the central component of those is a small coil of wire. Crucially, this effect gets more intense with heavier workloads. Since this is independent of temperature or mechanical components, it could, at the very least, prove to be a consistent indicator of 3D rendering. To test this, I put a microphone under my GPU and recorded myself starting up Portal 2. Looking at just the waveform, there's certainly some increase in intensity as time goes on, but that's likely just from the cooling fans, which, as we know, aren't that reliable in the long run. However, toggling the spectrogram, we do see one noticeable feature. In the higher frequencies, there's noticeably less activity in the first half of the recording compared to the second half, where high frequency noise is nearly constant. After isolating and normalizing this range, we get this waveform. Not only can you clearly tell when I started the game, you can even tell when I entered a more cluttered area. Now we're making some progress. Of course, since this is real-life audio, there's still a lot of surrounding noise, even in those higher frequencies. To filter that out, we can take advantage of the fact that coil whine presents itself in a few narrow frequency peaks. Electricity knows how to harmonize, which makes it distinct from other sudden spikes in this range. Naturally, the next step was to write a program that automatically filters for these narrow frequency bands and estimates the GPU activity from that. Now, I'll remind you, these are two completely separate computers that aren't communicating with each other in any way. But despite that, I'm able to get a pretty good estimate of the rendering workload from just a microphone. I think my favorite example is looking at a very visually complicated scene and then turning away and looking at the floor. There's an obvious difference in the graph, and that's how I know I'm measuring the right thing. You might also notice a 3-second delay in the graph, and that's because I'm smoothing out the values by taking the quietest sample from the last 3 seconds. Since coil whine is constant, this helps us further separate it from other noises. Unfortunately, to my knowledge, we've expended the list of acoustic options in the average computer tower. Unless you're still using an optical media drive in 2025, in which case you don't need any advanced audio filtering to pick that one out. Technically, CPU and disk activity can be estimated from those two LEDs on your computer case. But since these are wired directly to the motherboard, it doesn't seem fair to count these as a side channel attack vector. There is one blinking light that might prove to be the most practical example so far. Have you ever stopped to think about what those little lights on an Ethernet port mean? I sure have, and I always just sort of assumed that they're indicating some kind of activity. Turns out, that's exactly their purpose. By measuring the flicker of the green light, we should be able to get a rough estimate of packet flow. To test this, I connected a photodiode to a microcontroller and wrote a program that keeps track of the brightness of that green LED. Every blink usually represents one frame of network data, though this depends on your hardware. The actual amount of bytes being sent also varies between blinks, but in general, the correlation is pretty direct. You can see it working very clearly when I fire up a network speed test. This is by far the most reliable external metric we've looked at. And yes, it doesn't use sound as the premise of this video would have suggested, but as a result, it's actually an even more realistic attack vector. Ethernet cables often stretch across entire buildings, especially in offices, schools, or sometimes even apartments. Even if you have no access to the router's control panel or network statistics, this one LED can tell you who's using the most bandwidth. Throughout this video, there's been a lot of talk about technology, science, and programming, and these aren't the kind of skills that you're born with. They're incredibly valuable, but often seem like a chore to learn. That's why I want to introduce you to Brilliant. They're the sponsor of this video. When it comes to complicated topics in math, computer science, or engineering, Brilliant breaks it down super elegantly. At least, certainly better than my professors. Their lessons are visual and interactive, which for me makes learning less overwhelming and way more intuitive. Genuinely, since trying it myself for the first time, I've brought up Brilliant to my friends in conversations about learning material. There's just not much else that can compete. I figure that viewers of my channel will likely be interested in their programming courses, but keep in mind that they've got thousands of lessons in all sorts of topics, each of which, at its core, helps you become a better thinker and problem solver. You can start learning today for free by heading over to brilliant.org/portalrunner, or scanning this QR code, or clicking the link in the description. You'll also be getting 20% off an annual premium subscription, which gives you unlimited access to everything on Brilliant. After everything we've looked at, it should be pretty clear that none of these so-called attack vectors are real concerns. At least, not for a personal computer. There are still plenty of dangers for things like data centers and communication infrastructure, but they've got some very smart people actively dealing with that. On one hand, I did just want to know how leaky a computer is in reality, just for fun. But I'll be honest, the original premise of this video was completely different. I wanted to see if you could transmit data through a side channel. So, to scratch that itch, here's my computer sending the word subscribe to my laptop by artificially blinking that Ethernet LED. In other words, instead of just sending those letters over the internet, I'm modulating how much garbage traffic I send so that the internet activity looks like data. So, yes, it's basically internet, but with extra steps. If you've enjoyed this, please do consider taking the advice on your screen. As of making this video, we're getting very close to 100,000 subscribers, and reaching that milestone would genuinely mean the world to me.